Hello, in this rather short tutorial, I would like to show you how we can introduce transparent glass into our optical models. Substrates are part of any optical model, so we have to know the optical constants of the substrate materials as good as possible. And in this section, I would like to show you how we can do that for glass, all kinds of glass actually. I like to start with this configuration that we built up when I showed you how to when I showed you the user interface of Scout and Coat. That's where we ended in this tutorial, and that's what we use to start here. There are basically two ways how we can get optical constants of glass and use them in for thin film computations. One is using a so-called wizard. That's a completely automatic scheme or automatic routine that takes reflectance and transmitted spectra and computes the optical constants automatically without doing any modeling. That has some advantages, that method, but also a disadvantage, which I will point out. And so sometimes it's much nicer to set up a real model for optical constants and to fit the model parameters, and that is what I would like to show you in the second part. But first, let's do it the simple way. In order to use the so-called pane wizard, which will obtain the optical constants of our glass pane that we use as a substrate, we have to go to the tree view, open the layer stack, and select the layer which contains the glass. And once we have selected a layer of type thick layer that we have to use for thick glass, we can start here in the section wizards, the pane wizard. Actually, this will guide us in several dialogues to the solution. The first one here is a page where we have to import the reflectance spectrum. I have stored spectra in the so-called SpectraCalc format, in actually in this folder, and I have collected spectra of 4 millimeter thick float glass. This is the reflectance spectrum. When we read measured data, we get the spectral range and the number of data points, and we have to confirm the spectral unit. In our case, this is nanometers, and we press OK. And here you see the measured data, measured reflectance. You have to make sure that this is scaled between 0 and 1. In many cases, experimental data come scaled between 0 and 100. That means those are percent values. Here we need a scaling between 0 and 1. So if you have percent, then this would be in the order of 8 instead of 0.08. And then you have to click here on divide by 100 in order to divide by 100. Okay, the next step is the import of the measured transmittance spectrum, also in SpectraCalc format. That's this one here. You should notice that the transmittance is high, except here in the ultraviolet, and here it's zero if the wavelength is small enough. That will generate some problem for this method, because the method to compute optical constants directly from a reflectance and transmittance requires that both reflectance and transmittance are above zero and not zero, like this one here. So we have to exclude this range from the analysis. I will show you how we can do that. Next step here is to set the thickness and the spectral range. We have to click this button and type in the thickness of the glass in micrometers. So this is 4 millimeters, so it's 4,000. And now we have to set the spectral range for the analysis. Here we have to try a little bit. If we, let's say, start at 250, which is where the experimental data start, we will get an error message saying that the reflectance or the transmittance is too close to zero. So we have to do it again. And I think if we increase the minimum here from 250 to 300, there's no warning anymore. So that seems to have worked out. Next step here is the result already, almost the result. Here we can change the graphic settings. This is 4 millimeter float glass. And we have to set the graphics reasonably because this will be the appearance that will be stored in the database when we click on finish. In this case, we have to enter a name for the material. Let's say we can call this float glass. The database item that we are going to create needs a kind of author. That's me in this case. And a comment. Not a real comment. Okay, and now we can finally enter a name for the new database item for the pane that is generated. We can leave the standard name here and take a look where this is stored. This is stored in the code database in the subfolder panes. We can just confirm this selection. And now if we click on update lists, we will find here in the section paints the float glass 4 millimeter that we just generated. So actually once we did delete this, we cannot delete this layer. Actually, I wanted to delete this layer, but it's not possible because we still have a fit parameter pointing to this layer or used by this layer. So what I will do now is I open here the list of fit parameters by a double click. And I delete all fit parameters. Here we still have the float glass thickness and also the other thin films. When we built up this configuration in the last tutorial, we had declared these parameters as fit parameters. Now we undeclare these, so no fit parameters at all. So now we can delete actually all the layers and take from the paint subfolder here the predefined float glass 4 millimeter, drag it here. Answer the question, should be no, not inverted this layer stack, and then code enters the right material and this thick layer with 4 millimeter thickness. So now with F7 we see the spectra here that are simulated, and what we could do, we can now verify that we really reproduce the measured data. So I can import the measured spectra that we have used. I can use the import command here. Let's say call this, we can call the sample float class and import in the SpectraCalc format the reflectance. Okay, the unit here is nanometers. It's important to check that. And we also import the transmission spectrum that belongs to this sample. And here you can see that we almost perfectly fit, or not really fit, but reproduce the measured red curves with our blue simulation. So that's perfect. Why is this method using the pain wizard not always very good? Well, I can show you a drawback of this method. We can go to the tree view, take a list, look at the material list, and here let's take a look at the float glass object that contains the optical constants. And you can see here that the real part of the refractive index, the blue curve, is rather noisy. It shows some artifacts here at the end. I can zoom in a little bit using the cursor keys and the plus key on the numeric keypad. Sorry, I have to press Y first, and then I can zoom here. So this is the real part of the refractive index in detail, and you can see that the optical constants that we have determined automatically contain all the noise of the measured data. And well, you can say that's how it is. That's the price we have to pay, and sometimes you can just do it and don't care about these little not really nice features of the optical constants. So if you want to do something nicer, you have to use a real model and adapt model parameters, and I will show you now how we can do that as an alternative to using the pain wizard. So now let's go to the main view again. What I will do now, I will replace the float glass here that we have generated automatically using the pain wizard by one of my favorite model for float glass, which will not reproduce these measured curves exactly, but it will already look rather close, and we have to adapt only some parameters, which will be quite easy. Let's go to the tree view, open the layer stack, and replace the float glass that we have generated with the pain wizard by this glass float glass model. And every code installation should have this model in the database. So we could have taken it from the database as well, but here it was already in my list of materials. So now we have a model for the optical constants. We can take a look at the real part here. And if we zoom in, there is no noise. It's a very nice and straight, very smooth curve. So this is what I prefer when I determine optical constants. But of course, we have to fix some details still. Pressing F7 shows, okay, the blue simulated curve is not really reproducing the red measured curve, but you can see all the features are there. So just the blue curve here is a little bit too deep. That means these absorption features here, they are too strong. We have to make them weaker, and then it should work out. So in order to pick the right parameters to change in the fitting procedure, we should take a look at the model first, how it is made. Press F7 and open the float glass model. Press R for restore the previous fit, A for automatic scaling. And now we can, since this is a model, we have a sub-object here called susceptibilities. And if we right-click that, we will see a list of susceptibility contributions and all these objects together make up the model of the float glass. Actually, I will explain in the next tutorial about fitting transparent oxides and nitrides for thin films. I will show in detail how we build a model like this, how we build it up from scratch. Here we just use the predefined model for float glass, and basically it contains one OGL interband transition model. We will not really go into details concerning this model because that will be done when I discuss the oxides and nitrides. In addition to the interband transition model, it has a constant and it has a strong oscillator in the ultraviolet, also representing a high energy interband transition. And what is now important for our application, it contains several so-called Kim oscillators located at certain resonance frequencies, in this case given in wave numbers. So these numbers mean the resonance position in wave numbers. And these oscillators, they describe the absorption by impurities that are incorporated in the glass. For example, this one here at 9,300, that represents iron atoms or iron ions in the glass that lead to the broad absorption around 1,000 nanometers. Okay, so this is how the model is made. And since different types of float glass contain different amounts of impurities, what we have to change here in this model, in any case, are the strength values of the Kim oscillators, because the strength here, actually the square of the strength, is proportional to the concentration of those impurities. So these numbers here, squared, represent the concentration of impurities, and that should be flexible if we go from one float glass to another one. Okay, let's see if we can approach our measured spectra by selecting these strength values of the basically the impurity concentrations as fit parameters, and then set them free and adjust them to the measurements. So I will go to the list of fit parameters now, which is empty. Click on plus, which brings us the dialog for fit parameter selection. And then I click here on oscillator strengths Kim 3000. I hold down the control key to select the next impurity absorption band strength. This one, that one here, that was the iron concentration, and also the others. So all the oscillator strengths of the impurities are now selected as fit parameters. Now we just press start in order to let code automatically adjust those numbers. Let's see how far we can get without helping the program, so it can now decide by itself which parameter should be optimized. It's not really super good, so I press start again. Sometimes the fitting algorithm requires a restart. It sets fit parameters new. So sometimes a second or third round in the fitting helps. Okay, this looks okay. Probably I would like to help the program here, because this Kim oscillator strength at 21,000, this is really too small. So I would like to help code a little bit. Let's put an upper limit of 10 so that we can change the value by hand. Oh, sorry, that was the wrong parameter. Probably I was talking about this one. Yes, that's the one which we need to adjust a little bit nicer. Press start again. And now the model roughly fits. Well, what we can also do, in addition to adjusting the absorption bands, we can also tune the interband transition parameters a little bit. So in particular, we can tune the constant and the strength of the UV oscillator. So let's take a look at the glass model once more and on the model parameters. Actually, we can take the OGL interband transition model and adjust the strength and the gap energy and the gamma value a little bit, and on the other hand adjust the strength of the UV oscillator that represents a strong interband transition far away in the ultraviolet, and we can also, to be complete, fit the constant that makes up the optical constants, that adds up to the optical constants. So now if we start the fit again, the fine-tuning can fit here the reflectance spectrum a little bit nicer. The fit deviation that you can see here gets much smaller. So, and this is now becoming a very nice model that represents details, almost all the details here in our measured curves. Of course, you can always make any model better by doing a little bit more, introducing a little bit more effort or more parameters. I think in this case that's good enough for the next steps, because we want to use this substrate or similar substrates for thin film analysis. So before we deposit the thin films, we have to measure spectra of the pure substrate, like these here, and then adapt the float glass model. And now let's take a look at the final result. This is the float glass model, and you can see here a nice set of optical constants which reproduce the measured data without reproducing all the noise. And this is much more satisfying than the noisy spectrum that we have obtained with the pain wizard. And it doesn't take too long either, so it's not too difficult. So you can save this configuration using the name let's say we go to the optical constants, float glass fit. And then we can just use the same model for a different type of glass, which I also have prepared just to show you, once you have a model like this or a method like this, you can reuse it for similar problems. So now we can import spectra of a so-called white glass. That's purified float glass, where the iron is taken out and some other impurities as well. And I have prepared spectra of white glass also. You can load them, reflectance and transmittance. And you can see here that the transmittance spectrum is much higher. There is no absorption by iron impurities or other impurities. The absorption is weaker. The band gap is also shifted. So this, in the ultraviolet, the absorption is shifted to higher energies. So there's a good chance that we can just press start and adjust these parameters of our float glass model in order to reproduce these spectra also. Let's press start. And hope that the automatic adjustment of the fit parameters will also work in this case. Looks promising. Whenever you get impatient, you can press stop and start again. Then code restarts with new settings for basically some little jumps that it tests when it varies parameters using the downhill simplex algorithm. I will explain that in another tutorial, how that works in detail. So sometimes pressing stop and start again helps to improve the fit when you do it interactively like I do now. So that is going to be nice. Okay, and we can stop here, store this under the name white glass fit. And actually, I have another example which I would like to show you now, because that will be the substrate for the thin film dielectric tutorial that will come next. So that's a BK7 glass. That's similar to this white glass concerning the optical constant. So we can import the BK7 numbers. That's in a different folder, and probably also in a different format, in the XY format, just a text-based file format with one column of wavelengths and one column of reflectance or transmittance values. BK7R, that's the reflectivity, and here is the transmission spectrum. Okay, and in this case, I think we have the problem that these measured data are stored in percent. So that gives me the opportunity to show you what we do in this case. So the spectra here are not seen, the red measured data. Actually, they are scaled between 0 and 100, so they have values of 8 at least here in the reflectance. They are far above my screen. So let's open the tree view, and in the list of spectra, let's right click the reflectance spectrum here. Every spectrum object has in the actions menu the command to divide the experimental spectra by 100. If we do that, you can see already we get the red curves here, the measured data, and you can do that automatically if you like by setting an option in the spectrum object. The option can be found here, local, in the local menu, file options. You can click here on divide measured data by 100. If you have a check symbol here, then in the future, importing data, importing measured spectra always means that they are automatically divided by 100. Okay, we can set this option for the transmission spectrum as well. Okay, and if we now import, I will just show you, if we import the transmission spectrum, it's now automatically divided by 100 and it should show up here. Okay, as you can see, the BK7 measurement here is even more transparent than the white glass, but it's very close, so we should be there in a minute or so to have a good model for BK7. I can just press start and code will adapt our model to the new measurement values. Pretty quick. So it's easy to go from white glass to BK7. And now we have a very nice model for the BK7. What I will do now, I will rename the material and then I will store this configuration so that we can continue doing thin film analysis using this substrate. So first, I will save the configuration, BK7 fit. And then I will rename the float glass model to BK7 model. Actually, we can delete in the list of materials all the materials that we don't need and then save this configuration again so we just have the BK7 model without anything else here. Good. We are now in the position that we have a very nice model for the substrate. And in the next tutorial, I will introduce thin films of two different oxides, and I will show you in detail how we set up an optical constant model for oxides and also for nitrides from scratch, showing you every detail. Fortunately, these models will be simpler than the glass model here. Usually it's just a constant and one OGL model, and that's it, and we don't need more. But that will be explained in the next tutorial. Thanks for your patience today. Bye-bye.